went to the Christian bookstore and I went and bought a Bible.
Yeah.
I need to read the Word of God. And we get into how did the street preaching, how did it get started on ministering. I started reading, the Lord took me right to Ezekiel chapter 3. And I started reading that, you know what, if I don't go and warn the wicked, that their blood's on my hands.
Yeah.
The first verses that I ever read in the Bible that I actually understood what the Bible said and what it meant.
Yeah.
And I said, I got to start telling someone about Jesus.
Yeah.
I got to start warning them, you know what? You're going to die and go to hell. That's what's going to happen to you.
Wow.
I don't care if you're on the high life. I don't care if you're down low. It doesn't matter. You die without Christ, you're going to go to hell.
That's, right.
That's what's coming for you. Fights there. I had my training camp set up and training out of San Antonio there.
UFC
and,
or boxing?
Boxing, professional boxer. And I had already been hearing a little bit of preaching and been around it. You know, my family and stuff was already saved, my grandfather, mom. And so the Lord was already doing a work in our life. My grandmother actually had sown the seed in my heart when I was 17 years old.
Amen.
And before she passed on and went on. The guy had some sort of Christian upbringing in his life. And at the end of the CD, there was a song there. And he opened up that song by saying, "What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and yet lose his own soul?"
Yeah.
Well, those are the words of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ.
Right.
So there I am in the morning. And after I would run every morning, and I'm hearing this at the end, "What shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and yet lose his own soul?"
Wow.
And so when God convicted me that night, it was those words that rang out in my mind and in my heart.
Yeah.
"What shall it profit a man to gain the world and yet lose his own soul?"
Yeah.
And I knew I'm that man. I'm trying to gain the world and I'm going to die and go to hell.
Yeah.
And I cried out to Jesus, "Lord, I need you. Save me. Clean my life. You know, do whatever you want to do with me. I'm yours, Lord. I surrender." I left there. I got up the next morning. I didn't know what happened that night. I just cried out to God. But I woke up the next morning, same CD in the car, and I heard all the stuff. I got it out. I broke it. I threw it on the floor.
What?
Yeah, I went to the Christian bookstore, and I went and bought a Bible.
Yeah.
I need to read the Word of God. And we get into how did the street preaching, how did it get started on ministering. I started reading. The Lord took me right to Ezekiel chapter 3. And I started reading that, you know what, if I don't go and warn the wicked, that their blood's on my hands.
Yeah.
The first verses that I ever read in the Bible that I actually understood what the Bible said and what it meant.
Yeah.
And I said, I got to start telling someone about Jesus.
Yeah.
I got to start warning them, you know what, you're going to die and go to hell. That's what's going to happen to you.
Wow.
I don't care if you're on the high life. I don't care if you're down low. It doesn't matter. You die without Christ, you're going to go to hell.
That's right.
That's what's coming for you.
That's right.
I started just trying to minister to people, trying to talk to people, and there came all the, all the people trying to come out and say, "Hey, you know, you need to calm down a little bit, or you need to, you know, just relax a little bit."
Yeah.
And the church I was going to was liberal and watered down. I didn't know that at the time.
Right.
But whenever I got saved, I knew, man, these guys are, they're telling people to come to the Lord for a better life and better. They need to get saved so they don't go to hell. That's why I need to get saved.
Amen.
You know, I'm asking these people, "Hey, why are you saved?" "Well, I need to quit smoking cigarettes."
Yeah.
You know, you need to get saved so you don't die and go to hell. That's
right.
Why.
Yeah.
And so I started ministering, things like that. Finally, God just threw me out, said, "Hey, you need to go somewhere else and do that." Started going out on the streets, giving out tracts, ministering to people, and I ended up coming. And this was before all the YouTube. I didn't even have a computer, so I didn't even know that. And so, but as it started coming together, I started seeing some videos, and I typed in, I was looking for everything. I think the first street preacher website I found was like the Street Preachers Fellowship or something. And I seen a picture of Brother Reuben on there. And I'm looking, and he's holding up a huge, it was one of the banners that you said. It was, just a huge banner, and had fire on it and everything. And I was like, now that's going out there saying something and doing something. So I started reading all the stuff, checking it out, ended up getting to YouTube videos and seeing some actual street preaching on YouTube and seeing it being done and hearing the preaching. And I was like, this is the page I'm on.
Yeah.
And this is the page I want to stay on. And these guys are on that page.
And so
praise the Lord. It just all took off from there. In that time, my brother had gotten saved. we were going out on the streets preaching to people, and the message was warning the people of the wrath to come.
Yeah.
Right. You know, just as John the Baptist said, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath
right.
to come?
Right.
And so the message hasn't changed. It's going on 11 years this February that I've been saved, and the message hasn't changed.
Amen.
Turn to Jesus or burn in hell. You need Jesus. Why? So you don't die and go to hell. That's why.
Right. That's why.
And
that's right.
And so, you know, that's my testimony. I thank the Lord for saving me and doing the work in my life. And praise God.
Praise God.
Amen. Amen.
Brother Gary, you want to go up?
Amen. I'm going to give you the why first of why I preach in the open air, and then the how, but the why is the most important. If you have the why, God will give you the how. And so I'm going to give you the why. I'm going to start with Isaiah chapter 55, verse number 11. We all know it, but Bible says, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. I preach because on December 6th of 2002, late at night, 32 years after hearing the gospel one time, I was saved.
Huh.
I was not in a church. I was driving my car north on Interstate 5, 60 miles north of Medford, Oregon, and at mile marker number 98, at the age of 49, right. I walked out of the wickedness of this world and turned to the only one that could save me, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In 1971, I was a senior in high school. I did not grow up in a church home. We didn't have a Bible. We never prayed, God bless this bunch, while we munch our lunch. The only time that I heard the name of God or Jesus Christ when my dad was mad, thou shalt not take the Lord thy God's name in vain. I'd never been to church. All I knew was some religious building. That was all it was. And at the age of 8, I was born in Springfield, Illinois, as the oldest of three at that time. I have a sister that's a year younger and another one 2 years younger than I. I don't remember how it came to pass, but it came to pass that we were going to go to Sunday school at the Southside Church of Christ on MacArthur Boulevard, two blocks over and three down. We didn't go very often. It didn't, you know, if we had a big extended family, so if we were out at the lake or something and burning hot dogs or whatever, and we got in late, we didn't have to go to Sunday school. We never went to church, none of that. And, Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And I'm so thankful for that. As a little child, my prayer was simply this: dear God, please don't let me die. And now, having taught Sunday school, I worked on a Sunday school bus ministry, that kind of stuff, I've realized that it's a very real fear, that children have a fear of dying.
Amen.
But let me jump forward to the why. The why is because I heard the gospel when I was 17. I was a senior in high school. I was cool. Anybody here a gearhead? There's people that like cars that are automobile aficionados, and then there's people that are gearheads. I live and breathe cars. We used to build hot rods. I had a 64 Corvette. It was a 365 horse, 327, and all the pretty girls in high school wanted to ride in it. Of course, I was only too happy to comply because I was full of myself.
That's right.
And anyway, a young man by the name of Bill Loos, L-O-O-S, I'd been a Boy Scouts with him about 5 years earlier. He used to bring his Bible to Boy Scout camp. And we used to laugh at him. Now, come on, we're at Boy Scout camp. We're going to talk smart, act stupid, talk about girls, and he's bringing a Bible. We called him Bible Bill.
Yeah.
But we had our sport with this guy. But in high school, about 5 years later, he came to me early in the week on a Monday or Tuesday, and he invited me to some church meeting at the Ford Theater in Waterford, about 10 miles down the road.
Amen.
And I thought to myself, buddy, if you think I'm coming to some church meeting on a Friday night, guess again. That Corvette's going to be polished up, and there's going to be a pretty girl in the seat, and we're going to go cruising the Ave. Well, the Bible says that the Word of God is quick and powerful. and sharper than a two-edged sword. Guess where he invited me? Every day he came to me and he invited me to that meeting. Guess where I was Friday night? I was sitting in the back row at the Ford Theater in Waterford, Wisconsin.
Man.
There was a preacher there. I can't tell you what his name was, what he looked like, what he preached. But he basically preached from this book. He preached that sin is dark, hell is hot, judgment is certain, eternity is long, heaven is sweet, and salvation is free. And at the end of the sermon, he gave a good old-fashioned Billy Sunday invitation. Every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. If you're a man, you come forward, and we'll have a man show you from the Bible what the Bible says, how you can know that you're going to be saved and go to heaven. If you're a woman, and I turned to the young lady that would be my wife of 27 years, and I said, let's get out of here. These people are a bunch of religious fanatics. Because you see, she was going to the Lutheran church and I wanted the girl, so hey, I'll go to the Lutheran church. Well, there, they didn't get in my face. I could go in there and I have an hour of religion, you know, and then I could go back to the world. I dip my toe in religion, you know. We would have, you know, we'd have, if you read the epistles, you read from the lectern. If you read the gospel, you read from the pulpit. When you talk to God, you face the altar. When you talk to the people, you face to the people. Stand up, sit down, I kneel at the union rail, at the communion rail, and I thought I was eating Jesus, the body of Jesus given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you, and I drink his blood and all the transubstantiation, they call it. And I had all of that. And that guy got to me, and I didn't like it because I liked that. Because that were the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. The Bible says that sin is pleasurable for a season. The ends thereof are the ways of death, but I didn't hear that part. I liked that world, and we walked out of there. And I did what this world said for another 32 years. I did everything the world said. You know what? Got an education, got a job, got married, a mortgage, two kids, the golden retriever. We had a golden retriever named Libby and a cat named Sam. We had it all. And that night, on mile marker number 98, 60 miles north of Medford, Oregon, I got saved.
Come on. Wow.
But for 32 years, why was it that when I would go to the fair, to the races, to any place, I drank copious amounts of booze. You name it, I've drank it. Martinis, beer, booze. How come I never saw anybody there with a banner saying the wrath of God is coming? I never did. I never had anybody walk up to me with a Bible tract and say, did you get one of these? I never had anybody come up to me and say, do you know what's going to happen to you? One time, I take that back, one time it was about 81, I had somebody come up to me and I blew them off. I used to use the name of Jesus Christ as a cuss word.
Yeah, what?
And that night I got saved.
Amen.
Well, how much I got? 2 minutes. Okay, I'll run through this. The how was, oh God, this was funny. I got saved. I was in a church in Temecula, California, Calvary Baptist Church. Tucker Braun got saved. He was 18. And he comes with Sutex books. He says, look at this. So we read these books, and you all know it. We went out and we did it the wrong way. I still make mistakes. I'm a newbie at this. I've only been doing this. The first time I opened my mouth or tried to open my mouth was May 31st, Memorial Day weekend of '06. And we went to Pastor Wrench and said, you know, we want to do this. He said, God bless you guys, go out and do it. And I'm thankful for that man. But we went out, we just messed it up. The first time I went out to preach, and I've been through Dale Carnegie and Toastmasters and stopped the meetings in Ford Motor Company. And the first time I went out to preach, you know what came out? Nothing. What a slack mouth. I grabbed the Bible, I started reading the gospel according to John. I tell young men that.
Amen.
You gotta go out and preach. If you can, nothing comes out, grab the gospel of John, just start reading it. But I've made every mistake there ever is. Right now I'm in Sacramento. I've been there for 3 years. I've been preaching for two. Glory to God, because I met Reuben on Facebook and God used him and his testimony to get under my skin to open my mouth.
Amen.
Mark 16:15, the Bible says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. God has personalized that for me. Go into all of Sacramento and preach the gospel to every creature. We do fairs, festivals, markets, parades. We start off with a 5K run on Saturday. We preach there. I'll give you the mechanics some other time. But That's where we go. We did the California International Marathon here a few weeks ago. We did the turkey run, or the turkey trot in Davis. We go from Davis to Rockland. We're just every week. The Capitol, I'm at the Capitol. They're always protesting and grousing about something. I'm there.
Amen.
So I'm sorry if I went
Thank
over.
You.
Glory
Thank
to God.
You.
And I'm honored to be here.
For covering for us.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank
you.
And it's been said there's no Christians in California.
Yeah.
There are Christians in California. There, we bump into each other every once in a while.
Yeah.
Pleasure to have that. God is going to use a lot of different people, a lot of different backgrounds, a lot of different testimonies. Of course, most of you know mine. I always give credit to my parents and what they did, their upbringing.
Catholic.
And oftentimes, you know, you are training your children to live holy and righteous.
Yeah.
And I'm fruit of that. You don't need a testimony of drugs and alcohol.
Amen.
And I'm very thankful that that happened.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm very thankful that I can have pressures and problems in my life. Very seldom will you hear me complain. I got the same financial problems, health issues, car breaks down, you know, before I leave. I got the same problems. I just don't air it out. And so when I have these problems, I don't reach for a cigarette.
Yeah,
I don't think
right.
about, well, I like a drink.
That's right.
I sure like to shoot some heroin in my veins. I'm very
Absolutely.
Thankful I don't have that wiring that that my parents did. And so when you raise your kids properly, they may not understand it, but I'm very thankful
yeah.
I didn't bite that apple. And oftentimes when people see me on Facebook, oh, this guy obviously got saved in prison. Look at the way he looks. Little do they know. You know, you talked about your parents sitting around at a table. Our dining room table was a marketplace for thought. We were allowed to talk about anything. And so, you know, we grew up with that. You didn't eat with a little TV tray in front of the TV. You sat down. You ate. Everybody talked. That's the way I grew up. And so it was a very good thing. Sure. Good wiring. We still do that today. And so what a blessing. Amen. And so my testimony is a little bit different. And you're going to hear different people's testimony. And so again, I'm very thankful for my parents to raise me, that I don't, in my everyday pressures of life and problems, that I don't go for a cigarette. I don't go for, wonder what a drink's like. And so God bless those that did. Doesn't mean that you're better off. And like I said, I've given the testimony before. Some of the places that we go preach, it helps not to bite that apple. You know, sometimes music can hinder a man. When we're out on Bourbon Street, brother, I you know, that music is a jarring a memory of what I used to do when I was a kid, and what I used to be involved in. Can we just go down the street? You know, we don't understand that even sometimes music can play a role to bring you back into maybe entertaining some bad thoughts. And so being raised with godly parents does influence you. And oftentimes my testimony is not very glamorous, not very Hollywood. Raised with good parents.
Amen.
And at a very young age, I still needed the same Savior as everybody else.
That's right.
That
That's
same
right.
Savior, that biker that is in prison, I still needed that same God as he. And, it is a good thing to raise your kids properly.
Yeah.
And I'm a result. Unfortunately, you don't hear testimonies like mine in churches. It's always a guy that gets caught up in sin.
Right.
And you rarely hear the prodigal son's brother's testimony.
Right.
That, hey, you don't need to have that. You don't need a testimony. There are sometimes we bumped into Christians who believe, I need to start getting involved in sin so I could get delivered and get born again.
Well,
and so you don't necessarily need to do that. And so once again, you're going to hear a variety of different testimonies. And so what we're going to do is have some prayer and break for lunch and meet back here about 2:15 and get it kicked off again by 2:30.